The Talmud confirms Christ's word. In the Talmud, in Treatise Sanhedrin, an extensive passage describes the right of the Pharisee to kill anyone, just as long as he did so indirectly. As one of dozens of examples, the Talmud tells us that if one bound his neighbor and he died of starvation, he is not liable to execution. In such an indirect manner, the Pharisees also killed Christ. Manipulating the Romans to actually wield the spear and sword, the Pharisees claimed, as their descendants do today, that since the Romans were the direct cause of the death of Christ, it is the Romans, not the Jews, who are guilty. Christ also called the Pharisees adulterers, an adulterous generation. The Talmud provides generous loopholes for adultery. It says the penalty for adultery does not include sex with a minor, the wife of a minor, or the wife of a heathen. The Talmud also encourages seduction of unwed adolescent girls called designated bondmaids. But it's important how such rapes are performed. With the designated bondmaid, one is guilty only in the case of natural connection, but not in the case of perverse connection. The Pharisees reason that rape in a perverted manner is outside the jurisdiction of the law. Normal rape, however, was punishable. In Babylon, sexual perversion of every kind had been a way of life for millenniums. The Pharisees were deeply influenced by such practices. In one of dozens of endorsements of child sex, Simeon ben Yohai said, "A proselyte under the age of 3 years and a day is permitted to marry a priest." Agreeing with ben Yohai, the great rabbi said, "When a grown-up man has intercourse with a little girl, it is nothing. Or when the girl is less than this, 3 years and a day, it is as if one put the finger into the eye." The footnote to this passage says, "As tears come to the eye again and again, so does virginity come back to the little girl under 3 years." The same section confirms that sexual activity with small boys is in the same category. The intercourse of a small boy is not regarded as a sexual act.
That's just part of it, and there's more. St. Maximilian Kolbe goes on more into this, and I'll put this up on the screen so you can read it for yourself, and I'll do a screenshot of the actual article so you can go to it. But he basically concludes, and he talks about the secrets of the chiefs of Freemasonry, and this comes. He says, "And you, small squadron of Hebrews, the quote learned elders of Zion, who have already consciously provoked so many misfortunes and are preparing yet others. To you I direct this question. What advantage will you gain? A huge accumulation of gold, pleasures, diversions, and power? But none of this makes man happy. And if still it should give some happiness, how long will it last? 10 years, perhaps, or 20? I ask you, Hebrew leaders, you have let yourselves be seduced by Satan, the enemy of humanity. Would it not be better for you to also return sincerely to God? So here, that was, you know, quote from St. Maximilian Kolbe, and he's trying to help the Jews to see that what they're doing, what they've been planning is satanic, that they're working against God, and to convert. And that's really what we're trying to help people in wherever you are, be it Protestant, Jew, Novus Ordo, traditional Catholic, to really see what is going on here and what the real problem is. And just to go back a little bit more in time to 1884, and this is Leo XIII in his encyclical against Freemasonry, and he points out that it is the communists and socialists under the direction of the Freemasons that are doing this. So this is a common theme, that the pre-Vatican II popes all saw this, all warned against this. Then you had a complete change after Vatican II, you know, beginning with John the 23rd in Pachamentaris, as you mentioned, Eric. And that really is a Masonic teaching. That document really is going from light to darkness. He completely perverts and changes what the church has always taught, and brings in complete free Masonic ideology in that document. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
No, I was going to say one point I failed to mention in my last quote with Pope Benedict. What I was alluding to with the just war, because you have people in the Novus Ordo, when you try to throw the concept of a crusade, I mean, first and foremost, I've explained this numerous times, it of course is spiritual first, in a sense that you know, we really need to batten down the hatches. We need to be praying the rosary every day. We need to be staying in a state of grace, you know, carrying out the basic doctrine of Christ, denying ourselves, taking up our cross, and following him, and following the Catholic faith. That's you can't follow Jesus without following his Catholic faith. So those who say they're following Jesus without following the Catholic faith, they're following themselves. And ultimately, like you talked about, concerning self-will, well, Jesus stated that only those who do the will of the Father get into heaven. Well, you're not doing the will of the Father if you're rejecting the Catholic Church. Okay, you're doing your own will, you're doing self-will, you're pursuing your own liberty, you're pursuing your own state of happiness. You're not pursuing what God wants. And that's what ultimately people have to come to the realization of. But what I was trying to allude at was this notion of Pope Benedict talking about, you know, fundamentalism and fanaticism. Well, again, you know, history demonstrates that the Crusades were more than justified. Again, if Christ has the right to rule, he has the right to rule through his Catholic Church, okay, via Catholic states, because, of course, in true Catholic teaching, unlike what the conciliar church teaches, there is no separation from church and state. And so the state is married unto the church in the sense that they must support the divine law so that more souls can ultimately get in heaven, you know, so that the churches are open, so people can get to the sacraments. And what's going to happen very soon, Christopher? The complete opposite. Churches will be shut down in communism. And so the states will be in this one world tyrannical, again, the Jew world order, as I've said it, okay, which is going to come through, you know, communism. It's going to be worldwide communism. It's going to break down the church and state. And so that's what happens when you slowly digress, you know, from the discipline of the heart. You end up into this self state, into the state of self. Okay. And so what I was alluding to with Pope Francis or Pope Benedict was the fact that people who are now actually holding on to dogma, okay, say on the Jews, we're seen as fundamentalists. I mean, we're not even seen as Catholics anymore. We're seen as fanatics for trying to put forth what the church truly teaches on the Jews. We're seen in this radical sense to where people need to understand that the majority are the radicals now. The majority are the liberals. They are the conciliar popes. They are those following. I mean, we're literally swimming in a world of liberalism, and it's proof that when you follow Catholic prophecy, how close we are to this liberal age ending, as Venerable Holzhauser indicated. Fifth age is about to end, and the sixth period is about to begin here very shortly. And that's what we're calling to. We're calling forth this new crusade, which in the future...